bulbar diseases. Yesterday we had a very grand session and very educative lectures. I hope today also you will be having a very exciting lectures, and I feel this will be very, very useful to your academic career. And I'm very happy to see all my associates who are very, very close friends of mine. Very happy to see Kaustubh, Vinod. How are you, Vinod? Unmute. Kaustubh.
Fine, sir.
Very happy.
Hello, Kaustubh. Hello.
Pragati.
Hi, sir. Morning, sir.
Pragati, I think
you are. Hi, Vinod.
Morning, sir.
There is a small change in the order. Now I first will start with Vinod, followed by Vamshi. Then Pragati is in third order. So yes, I think we will proceed with the symposium. Now I would request Dr. Vinod to present his lecture on echo assessment.
Sir, are you able to see the slide, sir?
Yeah, sure.
Are you able to see, sir?
Yeah. Very clear.
Yeah. Good morning to all of you. Today we are going to discuss about echo assessment of tricuspid valve. The tricuspid valve complex is similar to the mitral valve complex, but it has more greater variability. It consists of annulus, leaflets, right ventricle, papillary muscles, and caudate tendineae. The tricuspid valve has three leaflets of unequal size: the anterior, septal, and the posterior leaflets. The insertion of septal leaflet of tricuspid valve is characteristically apically located compared to the insertion of anterior mitral leaflet. The three main echo views which are important in assessing tricuspid valve are parasternal inflow view, apical four-chamber view, and subcostal view. So in each view, see, first one is parasternal tricuspid inflow view and short axis view, four chamber view, subcostal view. In all these four views, you can see only two leaflets simultaneously. Only in 3D echocardiography, we can see septal, anterior, and posterior leaflets simultaneously. First, we will see about assessment of tricuspid regurgitation. In almost 80 to 85% of the cases, the tricuspid is said to be functional. Tricuspid regurgitation is said to be functional, mainly caused by dilatation of the annulus as a result of increased PA pressure or RV pressure. Only in 15 to 30% of the cases, it may be organic. Mainly in India, it is due to tricuspid regurgitation, mainly due to rheumatic heart disease, secondary to rheumatic heart disease associated with the mitral valve disease. And small physiological degrees of tricuspid regurgitation is seen up to 60 to 70% of cases. On echocardiography, this physiological tricuspid regurgitation is associated with normal tricuspid leaflet without dilatation of the right ventricle. That small physiological TR usually localized in a small region adjacent to valve closure, less than 1 centimeter, with a thin central jet and often not extending throughout the systole. It will be maybe short part of the systole. And peak systolic velocities of tricuspid valve usually between 1.7 to 2.3 meter per second. This is regarding physiological TR. So what are the etiology of tricuspid regurgitation? I said already 70 to 80% of the cases are functional, mainly due to left heart disease, probably LV dysfunction, and the mitral valve disease are more common in India, followed by pulmonary hypertension, secondary to chronic pulmonary venous embolism, and chronic lung diseases, left to right shunt, followed by RV ischemia, RV volume overload, and RV cardiomyopathy causing RV dysfunction. And these are the main causes of secondary causes of tricuspid regurgitation. And primary causes are very less, congenital efficiency anomaly being more common. Acute India, very common is rheumatic, followed by endocarditis and pacemaker lead related injury. So how we are going to assess the tricuspid regurgitation severity based on echo? We divide into qualitative and quantitative method. In qualitative method, I divide it into color Doppler, pulse Doppler, continuous Doppler. Based on these methods, how to assess tricuspid regurgitation? First, coming to color Doppler. Color Doppler, we are going to measure three things: jet area, vena contracta, flow convergence. We know what is jet area. So when the regurgitation happens from RV to RA, in this picture, whatever we are seeing in RV, RA is the tricuspid regurgitation jet area. At the level of valve, we are seeing vena contracta. Above the vena contracta is the flow convergence. I'll explain everything in detail. Now, three components of color Doppler estimation: jet area, vena contracta, and flow convergence. First is jet area and characteristics. Color flow imaging, although less accurate, it is the most common way to assess tricuspid regurgitation severity in day-to-day practice. The general assumption is that as the severity of tricuspid regurgitation increases, the size and the extent of the jet into the RA also increases. Theoretically, large color jets that expand deep into the RA represent more TR than small thin jet that appear just beyond the tricuspid leaflet. However, the relation between the jet size and the TR severity presents a large range of variability, because in addition to severity of regurgitation, the color flow display depends on many technical and hemodynamic factors. Simply to say, jet size is, if the TR jet area is large, it doesn't mean it is severe. There are other factors which are very important in affecting the jet area. Number one is higher momentum. That is, when the regurgitant orifice area is larger, the jet area will be larger. When there is higher velocity of the jet, the area will be larger. When there is a central jet, the area appears larger. I'll explain everything in detail. Now, whenever the velocity is very high, that is, RA pressure is low, RV pressure is high, at that time, the severity of TR, the jet area appears very, very larger. The same severe TR, when the RA pressure goes up, the jet area appears smaller. Even though the severity of TR is more, when the RA pressure goes up, pressure gradient between RA and RV comes down, so the jet area appears smaller. Second one, entrainment. That is, whenever there is a central jet, area appears bigger. The same severe TR, if it is eccentric, it appears small area. So same severe TR, if it is eccentric, it is having lesser jet area. Third is lower Nyquist limit, that is color limit. If you are reducing color scale, the TR jet intensity will increase. Doppler gain, if you increase the Doppler gain, color area, jet area will increase. Now I'll show in pictures. This is apical four chamber view showing severe tricuspid regurgitation of equal severity. In the left side, you are seeing the tricuspid regurgitation central jet. Right side, you are seeing the eccentric jet. Both are severe in intensity, but because in eccentric jet, jet area appears smaller. So if you go by just jet area, falsely you will assume that this eccentric jet is a very moderate TR or lesser than moderate TR. But in fact, both are equally severe in intensity. So this is the number one. Second one, Nyquist limit. So when you are reducing your Nyquist limit, otherwise color scale from 63 to 50, 50 to 38, you can see the color jet increases, color jet area increases. When you reduce the color scale, the jet area appears bigger, falsely you can increase the severity of TR. Third one, color gain. If you increase the color gain from 25 to 56, you can see TR severity increases. Same TR, increase the color gain, increases jet area. Reduce the Nyquist limit and increase the jet area. And transducer frequency also. If you 3.5 transducer if you use, it will show a smaller jet. If you increase the transducer frequency, the jet area increases. So ultimately, jet area is a rough measure of tricuspid regurgitation. It is not a very specific, and because it is affected by various parameters. Again, I repeat, the central jet, eccentric jet affects the jet area. Pressure in the RA, that is pressure gradient across the RA, RV, affects the jet area. Color gain, increase the color gain, increases the jet area. Nyquist limit, increase the Nyquist limit or color scale, decreases the jet area. Probe frequency, if you increase the probe frequency, color jet area will increase. So just by looking at a tricuspid regurgitation jet area, don't go and come to a conclusion that it is severe tricuspid regurgitation, and you need other parameters also. In general, a color Doppler jet area of more than 10 centimeter square or a central jet area of more than 50% of the right atrium is considered to be severe tricuspid regurgitation. Color flow imaging should be only used to diagnose tricuspid regurgitation, not to quantify. A more quantitative approach is required when more than small jet is observed. So this is regarding jet area. So we have finished the first part, jet area. Second part is vena contracta. So the vena contracta is the narrowest portion of the regurgitant flow that occurs at or immediately downstream of the regurgitant orifice. So vena contracta is slightly smaller than the anatomical orifice. Thus, the cross-sectional area of vena contracta represents a measure of effective regurgitant orifice area. That is a true barometer of lesion severity. Visualization of vena contracta is technically less demanding than other methods. So how to measure vena contracta? You should take a four-chamber view where the tricuspid regurgitation is better seen. Zoom it. And zoomed view is very important because to minimize the measurement inaccuracies, because it is in millimeters. If you 6 millimeter is less than severe, 7 millimeter is severe. So each millimeter is very important. So you have to take a zoomed view. And vena contracta is typically imaged in a view perpendicular to the commissural line in the apical four chamber view using a careful probe angulation to optimize the flow image. Averaging millimeter measurements over at least 2 to 3 beats is required using 2 orthogonal planes if possible. The concept of vena contracta is based on assumption that regurgitant orifice is almost circular. But in tricuspid regurgitation, regurgitant orifice is not circular. It is like oval. So vena contracta is more useful for mitral regurgitation than tricuspid regurgitation. So vena contracta is independent of flow rate and driving pressure for a fixed orifice. So vena contracta is less affected by the eccentricity object. So when you have eccentric tricuspid regurgitation, JT area is not a very good measure. Maybe probably we can go for vena contracta, which is a better measurement in these cases. So the geometry of tricuspid regurgitant orifice because of secondary tricuspid regurgitation is usually more complex than mitral regurgitation because, as I already told you, it is not circular, it is oval, it will become more and more elliptical as the severity increases. In case of multiple jets, the respective values of vena contracta width are not additive. So ultimately, a vena contracta of more than 7 millimeter is in favor of severe tricuspid regurgitation. Whereas less than 6, it may be mild, it may be moderate. So we need other measurements to quantify whether it is mild or moderate. So as I already told you, vena contracta area, the tricuspid orifice is oval. If you take one measurement in horizontally, it will be less vena contracta. Vertically, if you take more vena contracta, so two sizes will be different. So vena contracta area, if you calculate, then it will be more accurate. How to calculate in 2D? You cannot calculate the area. You can calculate only width, either vertically or horizontally. But 3D color Doppler will be very helpful in quantifying the vena contracta area, which is very well correlated with effective regurgitant orifice area of the tricuspid valve. But the vena contracta measurement by 3D echo is still reserved for research purposes, not very much used practically. This is an example of vena contracta. Left side, you can see a jet of 0.3 centimeter showing a mild TR. Right side, you can see vena contracta of 1.3 centimeter showing a severe tricuspid regurgitation. This is how vena contracta will be very helpful, especially in diagnosis, severe TR, more than 7 mm if vena contracta is there. It is a severe TR. Next, flow convergence. Third point, we have finished already jet area. Next, vena contracta. Third, we have come to flow convergence. What is flow convergence? As the blood approaches to a regurgitant orifice, its velocity increases and it forms concentric and roughly hemispheric shells of increasing velocity and decreasing surface area. This creates the illusion of multiple concentric hemispheres of flow convergence, with each hemisphere having the same velocity, the smallest of which is having fastest velocity. Here you can see blue, green, and yellow. The yellow one is the flow convergence area where velocity is the same, and we have to measure the radius from the first aliasing velocity. First aliasing velocity is nothing but the junction of green and red, green and yellow color. So from there to the vena contracta, we have to measure the vertical height, that is flow convergence, that is PISA radius. So PISA radius is nothing but the vertical distance between the vena contracta to the top of the hemisphere. So flow convergence method is now by far the most recommended quantitative approach whenever is possible. The apical four chamber view is the best view classically recommended for optimal visualization of proximal isovelocity surface area. And the area of interest is optimized by reducing Nyquist limits to 15 to 40. The radius of PISA is better measured at a mid-systole using the first aliasing. And this is the flow convergence. So I already explained you, take a four chamber view, zoom it, put a color Doppler and measure from the top of first aliasing velocity to the vena contracta. This is the radius. This is the PISA radius. Right side, you can see the aliasing velocity is 38.5 centimeter. So locating the flow convergence proximal to the regurgitant orifice provides a qualitative information on both the location of the lesion causing the regurgitation and the magnitude of regurgitation. A well-defined small flow convergence with a small jet is specific for mild tricuspid regurgitation, while a large flow convergence presenting throughout the duration of flow is specific for severe tricuspid regurgitation. So the proximal convergence method is applicable for TR, but there is less experience with TR than with MR. It is more commonly used for MR. Qualitatively, a TR PISA radius of more than 9 millimeter at a Nyquist limit of 28 centimeter per second alerts the presence of severe tricuspid regurgitation, whereas radius of less than 5 millimeters suggests mild TR. So PISA radius is a qualitative assessment of tricuspid regurgitation. So we have completed jet area, vena contracta, flow convergence. Jet area more than 50% of the RA or more than 10 centimeter square, vena contracta more than 0.7, flow convergence more than 0.9, it indicates severe tricuspid regurgitation. So we have finished color Doppler. We are coming to the pulse Doppler. Pulse Doppler, only two things. Just put a Doppler across the tricuspid valve. One, put the pulse Doppler across the hepatic vein. These are the two things we are going to take. Pulse Doppler across the tricuspid valve. In the absence of tricuspid stenosis, if the peak E velocity is more than 1 meter per second in tricuspid regurgitation, it indicates severe TR. Next, pulse Doppler across the hepatic vein. Normally, hepatic vein, you can see a systolic forward flow. But in case of severe TR, the forward flow will become blunted and then it will become reversal. So sensitivity of flow reversal is almost 80%. But it is not very specific because it can be seen in other conditions like complete heart block when there is atrial fibrillation, right atrial and RV complaints. All those things will affect the systolic flow reversal. So this is a pictorial representation of hepatic vein flow reversal in tricuspid regurgitation. You can see instead of forward flow, there is a systolic flow reversal. This is also another example of systolic forward flow. I mean, systolic flow reversal in case of tricuspid regurgitation. So only two measurements in pulse Doppler. One is across the tricuspid valve, if E wave is more than one, and if the systolic flow reversal in the hepatic veins. Third one is continuous Doppler. This is very important. Continuous Doppler, commonly we use only two measurements, signal intensity. If the density is more, we think it is a severe TR. And contour of the envelope. If it is parabolic, it may be moderate. If it is triangular, it is severe. Why when it is severe? Because elevated right atrial pressure blunts the results in rapid fall in the pressure gradient. So this is an example of continuous wave Doppler. You can see first picture already I told you, hepatic vein flow reversal. Second picture represents continuous Doppler. Only two measurements in continuous, two parameters we have to look. What is the density? What is the character of the jet? Density in mild TR, it will be less dense. In severe TR, it will be more dense. And regarding the shape of the jet, it will be triangular in case of severe tricuspid regurgitation. So only two parameters we should look, density and the shape. So mild, these are the examples showing mild TR, severe TR. And sometimes when the TR is very severe, the jet velocity may come down due to increase in the right atrium. Last picture, the third one represents low velocity, but it is a severe TR. Why the velocity is low? Because the right atrial pressure is very high. So gradient has come down, so the velocity appears low. So don't just go by velocity alone. Then we'll be falsely assuming that it is a moderate TR. So this is a MR picture, but I am same principle applies to TR also. The first color Doppler showing mild, moderate, severe TR. Second showing pulse Doppler E velocity, E 43 centimeter, moderate 89. Then it becomes severe. E velocity is more than 1 centimeter, so 138 centimeter per second. Then third one is density. First one is faint. Second one is dense. Third one is dense. Dense means severe. Same thing shape also. Second one is parabolic. Third one is triangular. So when it becomes triangular, it is severe TR. And last one is hepatic vein systolic flow reversal. First picture you can see S and D. S is forward, then blunted, then systolic flow reversal. So this is very simple. So this is how we assess tricuspid regurgitation by all qualitative measures. coming to quantitative methods for TR severity assessment, in the three methods are there. One is PISA method, next is area assessment by continuity equation, third is volumetric method. But PISA method is the most commonly used method, very commonly for mitral regurgitation. Same principle will apply for tricuspid regurgitation. So what is PISA? Proximal isovelocity surface area. Already we have seen in flow convergence how to measure the PISA radius. So PISA radius measured in the four chamber view, zoom it across, zoom across the tricuspid valve and reduce the Nyquist limit to around 28 to 30. Get a beautiful hemispheric shell, measure the radius from the vena contracta to the first aliasing velocity. Here it, right side you can see black dot, that is the thing. So that is the radius. So P is a radius. So here you can see regurgitation flow is equal to 2 pi r square into aliasing velocity. So 2 pi into r is nothing but the radius of the flow convergence PISA. Next is VA is aliasing velocity. So I'll show in the next picture very clearly. So in this picture, left side, we can see the radius and left side, you can see the aliasing velocity 38.5. So pi r square, 2 pi r, 2 pi into r is the radius into velocity is 38.5 square. We can see the tricuspid jet velocity also simultaneous picture. The simultaneous frame only we should measure the jet velocity. So this is another example. Take a four chamber view, RERV, put a color Doppler, measure the radius. Step one, regurgitation flow is equal to 2 pi r square into VA. 2 pi r is equal to PISA radius. In this case, PISA radius is 0.9 into VA is aliasing velocity. Step two, after calculating regurgitation flow, effective regurgitation to RFACA area is equal to regurgitation flow by peak regurgitation velocity. Here, peak regurgitation velocity is 3.386 centimeters is the peak regurgitation velocity that should be calculated in the same frame. Step three is regurgitation volume. Once you calculated effective regurgitation to RFS area, then regurgitation volume is very easy. It is effective regurgitation to RFS area by time velocity integral of the regurgitation jet. Time velocity integral in this picture is 109 centimeters. So this is how we can calculate. So PISA calculation is very simple. Step one, calculate the regurgitation flow. That is 2 pi r square into aliasing velocity. Step two, once you calculate regurgitation flow, divide that with peak regurgitation velocity, whatever the TR jet maximum velocity that we have to put there. Once it is calculated, you will get a EROA. Once EROA you got, then multiply it time velocity integral. So regurgitation volume is equal to effective regurgitation to RFS area multiplied with time velocity integral of the regurgitation to RFS. So the PISA method is based on the assumption of hemispheric symmetry of the velocity distribution proximal to the regurgitation lesion, which may not be holding good for eccentric jets, multiple jets, or elliptical regurgitation to orifices. Practically, the geometry of PISA varies depending on the shape of the orifice and the tricuspid leaflet surrounding the orifice. As I already told you, the shape of the tricuspid annulus is not very circular, so there is a chance for mistakes. But the shape of the flow convergence zone is not a hemisphere. When you are not getting a very good hemisphere, the PISA method may underestimate the degree of functional TR, particularly when the ratio of long axis length and the short axis length in the 3D regurgitation orifice is more than 1.5. When there is an oval-shaped tricuspid orifice, very difficult to get a proper PISA area. Quantification of tricuspid regurgitation using the PISA method has been validated in small studies, but is not very commonly used clinically, but it's commonly used in mitral regurgitation assessment. So limitations of PISA assessment, as I already told you, regurgitation orifice should be circular, and rarely it is circular in tricuspid regurgitation. Jet, which is eccentric in origin, demonstrate a PISA that is not hemispherical. So when you get a good hemisphere, it is very good to, we can get accurate value. When it's not clearly hemispherical, we'll not get a proper value. Third, when there is holosystolic tricuspid regurgitation, we'll get a proper PISA. When you don't get a holosystolic TR, what will happen in the first half of the systole, you may not have TR. Second half of the systole, we'll have TR. So wrongly, we'll be getting 50, we will assess the TRS severe. So motion of the annulus also will affect the calculation, and measurement of PISA radius is sometimes difficult. These are the limitations of PISA method. This is how in this thing, this is an MR jet actually, but I just wanted to explain you the TR also will follow the same rule. PISA is inaccurate in the non-holosystolic regurgitation lesion. If you see in this frame, first frame, if you see it's a holosystolic MR. So the regurgitation is present throughout the systole. In the second thing, it's a late systole. In the first systole, there is no regurgitation. Second, there is a regurgitation. In the third, there is early part, there is a regurgitation. And the second half of the systole, there is no regurgitation. But basically, PISA is based on a single frame assessment. You will take a frame in the four chamber view. Based on the frame, you will assess. If the frame is taken in the first half of the early systolic regurgitation, you will get as if your systole is very severe. You will think that regurgitation is very severe. If you go to middle part, only you will get a 50%. So you will think that regurgitation is only moderate. So holosystolic regurgitation assessment of PISA is very good, but non-holosystolic, it is not so good. So color Doppler assessment in single frame measurements of severity, jet area, vena contracta area, flow convergence, effective regurgitation to orifice area, all these parameters are not accurate when the regurgitation is not holosystolic. They are very useful when it is holosystolic tricuspid regurgitation. Other less commonly used methods are quantitative pulse Doppler method. Next is volumetric method. Volumetric method is like stroke volume of end systolic volume minus end systolic volume of RV. You will get a regurgitant volume. Effective regurgitant orifice area is nothing but regurgitant volume by tricuspid velocity integral of the regurgitant jet. These are less commonly used. So what are the other indirect signs of severity here? RA RV dilatation, dilated and pulsatile IVC, a dilated coronary sinus, flattened interventricular septum, and the systolic bowing of interatrial septum towards the LA. RV ejection fraction is RV ejection fraction is a crude estimate of RV function. TAPC or currently assessment of is a commonly used assessment to assess the RV function, but they are still need to be validated for both right side and left side valvular rod diseases. So this is a small thing. I just want to talk about tricuspid annular dilatation. So normal tricuspid annulus in four chamber view is equal to 2.8 plus or minus 0.5 centimeter. When do we call significant tricuspid annular dilatation? When the diastolic diameter of the annulus is more than 21 millimeter per meter square, or when the absolute value is more than 35 millimeter in diastole, we call it as tricuspid annular dilatation. And usually when the annular dilatation is more than 35 mm, it correlates with the severity. Dilated annulus usually correlates with the significant MR. Next is TAPC. When the TAPC less than tricuspid annular plane systolic excursion less than 1.7 is abnormal, but in severe TR, it is not very accurate. To summarize, so I just want to summarize whatever we discussed till now. So how to assess a severe TR, mild, moderate, severe. I'll just discuss about severe TR. If there is a flyal tricuspid leaflet with a large perforation, with a RE-RV dilated IVC, structurally in 2D echo, we think it is a severe TR. Qualitatively, if you are seeing a large central jet with the area of more than central jet, a dense jet which is triangular, the jet which is present throughout the systole, we assume qualitatively this is a severe TR. Semi-quantitative measurements, that is when the color flow jet area in the four chamber view more than 10 centimeters square, or when it occupies more than 50% of the RA area, or when the vena contracta is 0.7 centimeter, more than 0.7 centimeter, or when the PISA radius is more than 0.9 centimeter, or when there is a systolic flow reversal in the hepatic veins, or when the E velocity is more than 1 meter per second in the absence of tricuspid stenosis, we assume that it is a severe tricuspid regurgitation. And quantitatively, if you are able to calculate the effective regurgitant orifice area by PISA method more than 0.4 centimeter square, or when the regurgitant volume is more than 0.45 ml, then it indicates severe tricuspid regurgitation. Severe, we can easily define. Less than severe, mild to moderate is very difficult. If it is mild, it is easy to diagnose. If it is severe, it is easy to diagnose. Moderate, then we need much more methods. So this is a table column flow chart. So chronic TR severity assessment, left side mild TR, right side severe TR. I'll just simply tell one thing. In left side or right side, if you get 4 points, directly go to the next step. For example, mild, if you are having thin, small central jet, first point. Second, vena contracta less than 0.3 centimeter. Third, PISA radius less than 0.4. Faint jet and systolic dominance in the hepatic vein and tricuspid annular A wave is dominant in flow. And these things with the normal RE-RV, if 4 points are there, directly go, you can think it is a mild TR. The right side, same 4 points if are there. Specific criteria, there are some 6 to 7 specific criteria. If you have 4 criteria, you can go to severe TR. Whether dilated annulus, non-coaptic leaflets, flyer leaflets with a jet area of more than 10 centimeter square, or with more than 50% of the REA if the jet is occupying more than 0.7 centimeter of vena contracta, PZ radius of more than 0.9 with a dilated RERV, with a dense triangular jet, systolic hepatic fine flow reversal. If all these things are there, we can go to severe TR. If it is an intermediate TR, we need quantitative measures. That is like effective regurgent orifice area or regurgent volume based on the PISA method. Then we can know whether it's mild, moderate, severe. This is about transthoracic echocardiography. Now coming to the role of transesophageal echocardiography.
Vinod?
Yes, sir.
Complete another 2-3 minutes, okay?
Yes. So TE is not very commonly used. Coming to tricuspid stenosis, 90% of the cases of tricuspid stenosis is rheumatic in India, and the MOD features are thickened valves and 2D echo. You can see doming thickened leaflets with a turbulent flow. And very important method to assess the tricuspid stenosis, very commonly used, pressure of time. As the tricuspid valve orifice area decreases, blood flow from the right atrium to right ventricle is increasingly affected, and the time required for blood flow to the RA to RV becomes longer. So what is pressure of time? The time required for the peak pressure gradient to fall by 50% of its original value. I repeat, the time required for the peak pressure gradient to fall by 50% of its original value in milliseconds is pressure of time. It measures the rate of decrease in pressure gradient between RA to RV. So tricuspid valve area by pressure of time is 190 by pressure of time. That is the thing. If it is more than 190 milliseconds, that is severe TR. So this is how it will be calculated. So if the tricuspid, if the pressure of time is more than 190 milliseconds, it indicates severe TR. It is 220 in case of mitral stenosis, 190 in case of tricuspid stenosis. So pressure of time is quick to do, independent of cardiac output, tricuspid regurgitation, and heart rate. It is very useful in tricuspid stenosis with the coexistent tricuspid regurgitation. And it is inaccurate when the complaints of a ventricle is abnormal. Pressure of time is not very validated in case of prosthetic valve. Mainly I'm talking about mitral valve especially. And it is unreliable when there is a severe TR, pulmonary regurgitation, or ASD. And continuity equation and is not very commonly used. So ultimately, severity of TS based on only few parameters. Number one, when the gradient continuously, if you put them, when the gradient across the tricuspid valve is more than 5 millimeter of mercury with a pressure of time of more than 190 milliseconds, value area by continuity equation less than 1 centimeter square with enlarged RA, we think it is severe tricuspid regurgitation. So I have completed my PowerPoints, and now we are there for questions. Sir, shall I go to questions now?
Display questions, sir.
Yes.
Only display.
Yes,
we sir. To them. What are the commonly asked questions?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
When we increase the Nyquist limit, what happens to the TR jet color area? It increases, decreases, doesn't change. So shall I go to next one?
Yeah, go to the next. Anyhow, we are giving PDF copies. In that one, we'll give answers also.
Yeah. Severe tricuspid regurgitation is diagnosed with above what measurement of vena contracta? Above what value we assume that TR is severe? 0.5, 0.9, 0.7, 0.8 centimeters. Third, hepatic vein flow reversal is affected by which of the following in the assessment of severe tricuspid regurgitation? Atrial fibrillation, elevated right atrial pressure, abnormal RERV complaints, all of the above. All of the following indicate severe tricuspid stenosis except mean gradient more than 5 millimeter of mercury, pressure of time less than 190 milliseconds, valve area less than 1 centimeter square, and time velocity integral more than 60 centimeter. PISA method to assess the TR is inaccurate in all of the following except oval orifice of tricuspid valve, eccentric TR, holosystolic TR, late systolic TR. Thank you.
Thank you, Vinod, for excellent presentation with the beautiful illustrations.
Thank you, sir.
Very thankful for honoring our invitation.
Thank you, sir. I'm also grateful for you, sir, for giving the opportunity.
You are all part of our group and you are close to my heart. Really,
thank you, sir.
I wish you a very bright future. You are already having a bright future, but all wishes from Shanshai.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much for presenting such a nice lecture and covering all aspects of TR and assessment of TR, beautifully narrated. Over to you, Dr. Shailendra Singh and Vijay.